we start this morning session. And from today, we will move in this room for the rest of this workshop. And the good thing for this room is there is an electric socket under your table for every seat. Yeah. You can find that. So you can enjoy your laptop as you enjoy the talk. So the first talk of this morning is by Kentaro Yoshida from Kyoto University, and his title is "The Recent Progress on Generalized Supergraphy and Neo-Master Automations."
Thank you for the introduction. So first of all, I would like to thank the organizers for giving me the opportunity to give a talk in this wonderful conference. So in this talk, I'd like to introduce the recent progress on general supergravity and Young-Fox formations. Okay, so then let me begin with the introduction. So I'm a string theorist, and I'm working on string theories mainly. String theories, as you know well, are permission candidate to unify four forces in nature. So however, string theories has not been completed yet. So in particular, string theory is defined only perturbatively, and there are various approaches to the non-perturbative formulations of string theories. For example, string field theory, the matrix model approach, or tensor model approach, etc. So here, I would like to start with these questions. Is there anything to consider for perturbative string theory? So, of course, there are a lot of approaches to consider non-perturbative formulations of super string theories, but here we are interested in perturbative string theories. So, one may thought of that there should be nothing to be studied for perturbative string theories. But here we are interested in perturbative string theories, and at least in this talk, the answer is, of course, yes. So, we will consider the perturbative string theories in more detail. So it will be helpful to remember three well-known formulations of perturbative string theories. The first one is the NSR formulations. This is based on Wallace's buildings. So then, in these formulations, we can use the CFT techniques to analyze this theory. So the second one is the Green-Schwarz formulations. This is based on space-time fermions. So then, the number of space-time fermions is redundant. So we need to impose additional conditions by hand. So in these formulations, Kappa symmetry is utilized to reduce the redundant number of space-time fermions. The third one is the Fiat-Skinner formulations. This is also based on space-time fermions, but instead of Kappa symmetries, Fiat-Skinner condition is utilized in these formulations. So here, we are interested in the Green-Schwarz formulations, this second one. Okay? So then, there are several versions of superstring theories, but here we are interested in type 3 superstring theories. So we will consider the Green-Schwarz formulations of type 3 superstring theories in this talk. Okay, so then these theories contain space-time fermions. Space-time fermions has 32 components. This means 260 components of Majorana-Weyl spinors. So then, by using the Gaussian conditions for space-time fermions, we can reduce the number, this 32, to 16. But the number of physical components should be 8. This is redundant, so we need to reduce 16 to 8. So it is necessary to impose additional conditions. So this is nothing but the Kappa symmetry. This Kappa symmetry is a fermionic gauge symmetry. So by using this fermionic gauge symmetry, we can get away redundant space-time fermions. So then we can get the correct number of the physical components of fermions. So anyway, this Kappa symmetry is very important to get the consistent string theories, at least at classical level. So here, let's remember the old, very important fact shown by Dussler et al. In 1985. This is very old result, but this is very important fact related to this capacity. So if we start from the initial conditions of the standard type 3 supergravity, so then the confined variance of this string theory is automatically ensured. So this is important result. So the on-chip conditions of the standard type 3 supergravities led to the confined variant green Schwarz result. But the inverse has not been shown. But in this paper, the inverse was conjectured. But actually, it was not true. So we need to rephrase this statement like this. So this is a new result shown by Zetlin and Wu last year. So this is a very brand new result on this capacitometry and the on-chip conditions of type 2 supergravity. So new research says that the confined invariant green Schwarz string theory is defined on an arbitrary background. We can get the generalized type 3 supergravities rather than the standard type 3 supergravity. So this is a bit surprising result. So anyway, a confined invariance leads to some positive conditions for the background field of the string theory. So then, by directly solving the capacitometry constraint, we can get the generalized type 3 supergravity rather than the standard type 3 supergravity. So anyway, the inverse issue has been resolved after more than 30 years from the old work. The old work has been done, was done in 1985. And so after more than 30 years from this old work, this issue has been solved. So anyway, this is recent fundamental progress of string theory. So what does this result indicate? So of course, this result indicates that low energy effective theories emerging from string theories may be more general than the well-known supergravities. So here, generalized supergravity is nothing but the generalizations by including an extra vector field. So generalized supergravity includes an extra vector field as a new ingredient in addition to the original type 3 supergravity. So we may have missed an important ingredient, this extra vector field, in the context of string phenomenology for more than 30 years. So this is a very important point. So anyway, it is really significant to study the general type 3 supergravities in more details. So it may be possible to get a nice idea to solve the long-standing problems, such as cosmological quantum problems or stabilizing projective vacuum. So now we have very strong motivations to study this generalized type 3 supergravity.
One question.
Yeah.
If the equality is correct,
it's 40.
It means that when you want to construct superstring theory, you also have to include this extra vector field as one component of superstring theory.
As far as we believe, so there is no reason to exclude this extra vector field.
Vector field is a super field. Supersymmetry field.
Supersymmetry
field. Vector field.
You ask if this is a complete supermodule or just a bosonic component.
Is it
dynamical?
It's just a bosonic component. And actually, this does not join to the supermolecule, actually, it's not a dynamical field. This is just a background field. What is the generalized type 3 supergravities? So, in the first place, I will introduce a set of the defining relations of the generalized type 3 supergravities. So then, I'd like to briefly introduce a history of the discovery of this generalized type 3 supergravities in relation to the study of Young-Baxter deformations. So then, I'd like to explain what is the physical interpretation of this extra vector field I. So anyway, in particular, answer is very simple. This extra vector field is nothing but a non-trivial flux. So this is the main message of my talk. So then, finally, I will summarize my talk. Okay, so then, let me introduce what is generalized type 3 supergravity. So this is a set of the equations of motions of the generalized type 3D supergravities. So this is the equations for metric, this is the equation for NSN2-form, electrons, Ramon-Ramon-1-form constraints, 3-form constraints, 5-form constraints. This is the divisions of energy momentum tensors appear here. And these are the modified Young identities. So what parts have been modified? Take a look at red box and green box and blue box. So you can see three ingredients as a new ingredient here. So extra vector field, X, G, and I appears. But please note here that there is no kinetic curve for these vector fields. So these vector fields are vacuum fields, not dimensional. So then, anyway, the equations of motion contains new three vector fields, X, I, and Z. But here, there are some conditions for three vector fields. So first of all, X is given by I plus T, and so anyway, two of them are independent. So then, I and Z should satisfy these relations. And so we need to impose these relations for these vector fields. So then, by assuming that capital I is chosen such that the d derivative of B field, just like this, this vanishes, so then the standard equation here can be solved by taking these combinations. So then, capital G is given in terms of I. So, after all, only capital I is independent. So, when I equals zero, the usual type 3 supergravity is produced. So anyway, this is a very simple generalization of type 3 supergravity. So here, I'd like to make some comments. In the original papers, Arjun et al. And the Tetri and Root papers, the cluster actions has not been constructed. They constructed the equations of motions of the generalized type 3 supergravity only. But it has been shown that the generalized type 3 supergravities can be reproduced from the cluster actions of the standard double field theories or exceptional field theories by taking slightly different section conditions. We usually impose the canonical section conditions for DFT and EFTs, and we will get the type 3 supergravity and type 3 supergravity. But by taking the slightly different section conditions, we can realize the generalized type 3 supergravities or type 3 supergravities. So type 3 supergravities have not been constructed in the previous papers, but in this paper, we constructed the generalized type 3 supergravities as well. This is a byproduct after embedding the generalized supergravities into double field theory. Okay, so it's not here that the generalized type 3 supergravities was originally derived in another context, in the study of integral deformations of the ADS 5-5 superstring. This integral deformation is called Young-Maxwell deformations, and the word Young-Maxwell deformations included in my talk titles. And anyway, the study of Young-Maxwell deformation is closely related to the discovery of the generalized 5-3 supergravity. So in the following, let me briefly introduce what is Young-Maxwell deformations. Okay, so then this is the Young-Maxwell deform actions of the ADS 5-5 superstring. So this is the cluster actions. So these actions contain these factors here. So these factors contain the constant parameter data. So when eta equals zero, the deformation is removed and the original undeformed actions constructed by inside from the state. So anyway, this part is a very important part in this deformation scheme. And anyway, this capital R plays a central role in the context of Young-Maxwell deformations. So this factor can measure integral deformations. I mean, integral deformations can be speci- by inserting classical R matrix here. So anyway, this is a scheme of Young-Baxter deformations. So anyway, a classical R matrix can label integral deformations, and we can consider two sources for classical R matrices. This classical R matrix is to satisfy the classical Young-Baxter equations. So we can see two sources for classical R matrices. The first one is a modified classical Young-Baxter equations utilized by delta vector. And the second one is a homogeneous classical Young-Baxter equations employed in a paper. So anyway, this classical R matrix is satisfies classical Young-Baxter equations, and the solutions, so in other words, solutions of Young-Baxter equations labels integral deformations. So that's why this deformation scheme is called Young-Baxter deformation.
How do I know that is the good deformation? And or is it the unique deformation?
So what do you mean by good deformation?
Integrability.
So integrability is ensures because we can show the existence of classical Lattice pairs for the revolved actions independent of complete expressions of classical R matrix. So the classical integrability is ensured in the sense of the kinematical integrability. So as I explained here, so anyway, classical integrability is ensured by explicitly constructing the Lattice pairs, classical Lattice pairs.
Are there similar construction for membrane, super membrane?
Actually, I'm not sure. Yeah, because we can consider the Young-Baxter deformations of type 2 S3 super thin series, and so we can maybe consider integral deformations of super membrane series, but I have no ideas how to deform the membrane actions.
Generalize 11 dimensional supergravity, maybe you can get some dimension.
I have considered that issue briefly, but I have no complete ideas. Okay, so anyway, this is the Young-Baxter deformation for the ADS 5-5 superstring. So then, let me show you an outline of superposition constructions. So anyway, this action takes a quite abstract form. So because this action is written in terms of the group element, this character A is a usual rectangular element one form, G inverse DG. So G is a group element of the superposite, which describes the ADS 5-5 supergeometry. So then, we need to make a representation of the group element. So then, we can introduce a coordinate system. So then, we can consider the complete background for this deformed background, for this deformed system. So then, by expanding with respect to the space-time gradients, we can rewrite the constructions into this canonical form. So this canonical form contains the information on metric and NSS 2 form, and this capital D is the Fourier derivative for space-time gradients. This capital D is defined by this one. So this capital D contains the information on dilatons and lambda 1-form field strengths, 3-form field strengths, and 5-form field strengths. So all of the components of type 3 supergravities are included in this canonical form. So by rewriting the deformed actions into this canonical form, we can read off all of the components of type 3 supergravity. So anyway, the computation scheme is very simple, but the computation is very hard. So it hasn't been done through the 2 years ago. But anyway, now we have techniques to perform superposition constructions explicitly. So we can read off the full background for the Young-Baxter deformed actions. So anyway, so let me show you a summary of the resulting background after performing Young-Baxter deformations. So this is the first case based on the modified classical Young-Baxter equations. So this case is often called eta deformations or standard Q deformations or sometimes kappa deformations. A lot of names are assigned to these deformations, but anyway, all of them are equivalent. So anyway, this case, we could not get a background which satisfies the equations of motions of the usual types of supergravities. So this was pointed out in the statement. So then, Algernon constructed the generalized types of supergravity equations of motions in his papers to support the deformed actions as the solutions. So the original introduction of the general supergravity was quite artificial. So in order to support the deformed background as the solutions, so they decided to deform the type 3D supergravity itself. So this is the original derivation of the general type 3D supergravity. I think that at this moment, no one has believed the general type 3D supergravity is valid or justified. But now, we know the fundamental derivations of the type 3D supergravity, general type 3D supergravity are based on the capacitance constraint. So now we know the fundamental derivations of the general type 3D supergravity. Okay, so then let's see the result based on the homogeneous classical Young-Gauss equations. So in this case, there is an important condition called unimodularity conditions. So if a classical R matrix satisfies this unimodularity conditions, then the resulting deformed background should be solutions of the standard type 3D supergravities. So under these unimodularity conditions, we can ensure the on-shell conditions of the usual type 3D supergravities. But otherwise, the background becomes solutions of the generalized type 3D. So this condition is very important to distinguish the standard supergravities or generalized supergravities. So anyway, so under these conditions, we can discover the well-known integral deformed backgrounds. For example, universal background and universal backgrounds are included in this case under this unimodularity condition. Okay, so before closing these sections, I'd like to show you two examples of classical R matrices and deformed backgrounds. The first one is a unimodular classical R matrix. So let's consider this classical R matrix. This classical R matrix is represented by using these Kalman matrices. So anyway, by putting this classical R matrix into the deformed actions, then by rewriting the actions into the canonical form, we can read off these fields. If we can give field and electron and Ramon field strengths. So this is nothing but the solutions constructed by Hashimoto Izagi and Marta Russo in 1999. This background is considered as the gravity dual for the non-commutative gauge theories, I mean any four-pole supergravity theories defined on the non-commutative plane. So anyway, so this is a very famous example constructed by Marta and Russo. And the, okay, so then let's see the second example. This is a non-unimodular classical R matrix. This classical R matrix contains two parameters, A1 and A2, and this is the two parameter families of classical R matrix. So then, by putting this classical R matrix into the deformed actions, we can get this deformed background. So in order to support this background to be a solution of the general supergravities, we need to turn on this capital I, like this. So anyway, by taking this combinations of I and C, we can see that this is a solution of the generalized type 3 supergravity. Okay. So then, let me explain what is the interpretation of the extra vector field I contained in the generalized supergravity. So this part is based on these papers. Okay, so then, so far, we have considered the closed-string pictures by using the closed-string metric and NSF2 form and closed-string coupling. So, but it is also interesting to consider the open-string pictures by using open-string metric and non-commutativities and the open-string coupling. So, these quantities are related to each other through these relations. These relations are well known. So, anyway, let's consider the open string pictures of Young-Gauss deformations of ADS5 with the homogeneous classical Young-Gauss equations. So then, the result is very simple. Open string metric is not deformed. So unformed radiation source 5 is obtained as the open string metric. And the open string coupling constant is, open string coupling is constant. And only the non-commutative parameter, theta mn, depends on the deformations. Okay. Classical, the information on the classical R matrix is encoded into this theta mn. So, anyway, classical R matrices can determine non-commutativities. So then, let's consider the relations between the initial conditions of supergravity, so general supergravity, and non-commutativities. So let's see. First of all, let's see the let's consider the initial conditions of the usual type-3 supergravities under the unimodularity conditions. So then, we can show these divergence conditions for the non-commutativities. And this condition is very important to define the cyclic properties of the star product on the dual gauge theory side. Then, let's consider the case of the generalized type-3 supergravities. So then, this divergence condition is modified like this. The extra vector field appears here as a source term. So this is divergence formulas, and this relates non-commutativity to the extra vector field. So anyway, this is a first result that relates the extra vector field to physical quantities like non-commutativity. So what is the implications of this divergence formulas? So this formula was derived by considering Jahn-Bachsa deformations of AD surface 5, but this may be much more general. We consider that this divergence formula should be much more general. It should be valid for one general solutions or the general type-3 supergravity. So please note here that the transformation to the open string metric appears in a different context as well when considering duality transformations. So in this context, open string picture is forgotten, and the non-commutativity is just called beta field. So the field definition is sometimes called the beta transformations. So anyway, the theta mn is nothing but the beta field in this context. So anyway, let's consider the beta field in this duality context. So then, by using this beta field, we can introduce a certain flux called Q flux. So this Q flux was introduced by Planner, Minashian, and Fedorini, and Wolfram in 2008. This is the definition of the Q-flux. So please note here that this derivative is not the covariant derivative, but usual derivative. So this Q-flux is not a tensor. So this Q-flux should be regarded as a connection, such as a connection. So then, for a constant shift for a certain direction of x to x plus 1, we can introduce a monotomy defined by these relations. By integrating these definitions, we can get this monotomy. So then, if this monotomy is non-trivial along these x directions, this flux is called non-geometric. So this is the definition of non-geometric flux by using these definitions of Q flux. Okay, so then, let me show you our proposal. So our proposal is this formula. So the extra vector field capital I is nothing but the covariant derivative of the beta field. So this is nothing but the divergence formula. And so this is just a reinterpretation of the divergence formula. So anyway, this extra vector field is represented as a phase of Q flux plus Christoffel symbol corrections. So this is our proposal. So when extra vector field I is non-trivial, solutions may be non-geometric in general. So in this paper, we have checked some Jahn-Bachsa deformed patterns with non-trivial I and computed the monodromy. So we obtained non-trivial monodromies for general Jahn-Bachsa deformed patterns. And in particular, at least for some Jahn-Bachsa deformed patterns with non-trivial I, the deformed background can be regarded as T-fold. Okay. defaults are examples, simple examples of non-geometric backgrounds. And what is default? So default is a generalized notion of a manifold. It is locally a Riemannian manifold, but the patches are grouped with different width and T-duality. So T-duality is included. So this is a new point. So this is a picture of default. And this is a generalization of the usual torus. So the point is that, so let's start at this cycle. So the size of cycles changes as we move along this line. So then the size of the radius is quantified. So we cannot use diffeomorphism of physics to group these patches. But by using a TDRP, so we can change the size of this radius. So then we can group this cycle and this cycle, and we can close this geometry. So this resulting geometry is nothing but a default. So anyway, this type of structures appears as Young-Bachstad deformations. So this is the result shown in these papers. So anyway, global structures of Young-Bachstad deformed background is quite non-trivial and in general non-geometric. Okay, so then let me give a point. What happens to string large shift theories? So in the original paper by Arthur Pepper, they said that when the background is a solution of the general supergravity, scaling invariance of the string large shift theory is ensured, but value invariance is not. So it seems that the value invariance has not been preserved for the generalized supergravity solutions. So it used to be considered as a hypothesis. So to resolve these issues, the double field theory picture is very useful. So we consider these problems by using the DFT pictures. So then, as a result, by allowing the dilatons to depend on the dual coordinates, the appropriate counter terms can be constructed in order to cancel out the trace anomalies. So this is nothing but modifications of the Hradkin Zetlin term. So anyway, by slightly generalizing the dilaton dependence of the Hradkin Zetlin terms, we can cancel out the trace anomalies even for the solutions of the generalized supergravity. So anyway, in this paper, we consider the positive string case, and we show the cancellations of the trace anomalies. So we believe that the string theories on the generalized background should be very invariant. But please note here that in the case of superstring theories, the analysis should be much more complicated, because we need to compute the beta functions for the elementary fields. So it is quite technically complicated to diagonalize the Feynman actions. So superstring case has not been considered, but the essential part of the proof of the value invariance has been resolved in this positive string case. So we believe that the string theories on the general background should be very invariant. Okay, so let me summarize my talk. So in this talk, I have given a review of the recent progress on the general supergravities and Young-Bachstad deformations. So important point is that the supersymmetry constraint of the Green-Schwarz superstring theories leads to the generalized supergravities beyond the usual type 3 supergravity. So this is the list of the results. So Young-Bachstad deformations can be utilized to generalize solutions of the generalized supergravities, and the solutions of the generalized supergravities are non-geometric in general. And we argue that superstring theories defined on the generalized background may be very invariant. So anyway, we need to do much effort to confirm this statement. But anyway, we believe that the string theories in the generalized background should be value invariant. Okay, so let me make some comments for future directions. So the first one is an application of the general supergravity to Feynman analysis. So anyway, I'm very interested in considering the cosmological constant problem for stabilizing the Wichita brackets. In the preceding works, the geometric cracks utilize to suppress a cosmological constant severely or to stabilize a digital vacuum. So anyway, in the context of the general supergravity, a special kind of non-geometric flux appears. So that is a lot general non-geometric flux. So I'm not sure. So this special kind of non-geometric flux is enough to suppress post-mortal constant or to standardize the digital vacuum. But anyway, it's very interesting to consider these problems in the context of the general supergravities. And the second one is the black hole solutions, construction of the black hole solutions. So the black hole solutions have not been constructed in the context of the general supergravities. So I'm interested in the black hole entropies or the holographic interpretations of the non-geometric black holes. And the final one is very ambitious. So it is very interesting to look for a fundamental foundation to super-string theories beyond the green super-string theories. So anyway, by solving the capacitive constraint of the green super-string theories, we got the general type 3 supergravities. But this general type 3 supergravities includes only a trace of non-geometric q-quarks. So of course, we know other non-geometric quarks, for example, non-geometric quark quarks, or other non-geometric quarks should exist. But a special kind of non-geometric flux is supported by the general supergravities. I think that this result may indicate that there should be much more fundamental formulations of super-string theories beyond the green super-string theories. Actually, the green super-string theory is just an example of the formulations of super-string theories. So there should be much more fundamental formulations. So I think that this is the important direction. Okay, I'll stop here. Thank you for your attention.
Introducing the new field of vector field, do you have extra symmetry in addition to the usual symmetry of the supergravity?
So you mean between the extra vector field and the surface symmetries?
Yeah, the symmetry of supergravity is, of course, well understood, but including this new field, you have some new symmetry.
Reform. So, what do you mean by symmetry of supergravities? So, is there a diffeomorphism of actually supergravity? Or, yeah, actually, so in the context of W field theory, the diffeomorphism is generalized to the general diffeomorphism by including trivialities. So the actually the including the inclusion of trivialities is very essential to realize general supergravities in the context of W field theories. So in this sense, trivialities should be closely related to the appearance of this vector, extra vector field.
Maybe I'll follow up on discussion just to make it a bit more clear. I mean, supergravity has a local supersymmetry, as a symmetry. Mm-hmm. So now including this vector field, is it possible, you mentioned at least something about non-commutativity. Is it possible to understand the modified theory as some sort of a modified, deformed local supersymmetry? Or if not, maybe people think about this in this direction?
Yeah, actually, yeah, there should be the local supersymmetries, even for the generalized supergravities, but I'm not sure. Actually, that no one has constructed the supersymmetry transformations for the generalized supergravities.
So, is there any more questions? Okay, cool. With kind of symmetry, you said Sitchin showed that fab symmetry induced the generalized supergravity. Is only for type 2b or including type 2a?
Yeah, actually, Sitchin and Wu constructed the generalized type 2b and generalized type 1, and they make a short comment for the generalized type 2a.
Okay, if there are no more questions, thanks, Peter. Okay.